Now, you were born in Catford, in London, in 1949. And actually, we're quite privileged because we've actually got some footage of you playing in the garden. Mm. Very rare footage. Here's your brother, Dominic, actually attempting to cut off your head with an axe. A very rare footage as well, a garden in Catford.
He's dead, my brother. So he will be later on.
Oh, right.
You look worried for a second, he's dead. Oh, no.
Dead? Dead? It's just nothing about
dead. He will be.
Your mum was Irish, but your father was Italian, wasn't he? And he had his own ice cream van. And you used to help out, didn't you, behind the counter as well?
And the idea is you'd put this liquid mix in the top of this hopper in the machine, and it would whip it up and freeze it, and you'd pull the handle down and pull off one of these cornets. And you have to keep checking the hopper to make sure it's got some liquid mix in there to make the ice cream. So my brother was, occasionally would stick his finger in the top to make sure there's enough mix in there, top it up a bit more if it needed it. So one time he stuck his finger in, and this blade spinning round has chopped the very top of his finger off, and there's blood everywhere. And he's actually coloured the ice cream quite strongly. So my dad said, no, that'll be okay. We'll run with strawberry flavour ice cream.
Oh, no.
What do you mean, oh, no?
It makes me think I would hate to try the rum and raisin.
Ah.
Because it rather gives light to the claim on the photo, on the side of the van. Yeah. On the side of the van, it actually says, manufactured by modern and hygienic machinery. Now, right from the start, you actually wanted to be a rock star, or almost from your earliest days.
Yeah.
And we've got a copy of your school report, and here, amongst the D's and the E's, it actually says on there, at present, Francis is living in a world of make-believe, waiting for sudden and exhilarating success as a popular music idol.
One English teacher said to me, she was teaching me French, which was, yeah. But she said, one day, you think you're going to be a pop star? I said, well, yeah, you know, Jack LaLanne, yeah. And she said, well, then you may go on tour abroad. I said, yeah. And she said, well, you might go out to France. I said, yeah. And she said, you'll need to speak French. I said, no.
And she said, why? You can hardly speak English.
No, exactly. It's much the way to be. Yeah. And so I said, well, no, someone will do it for me. I mean, I was right that someone did it for me, but now I want to do it myself. So I was the dickhead. I lost out. Yeah.
But you were actually supported by your dad, because he bought you your first electric guitar.
Yeah, he's great, my dad. Yeah.
But he failed to get you an amplifier, I understand.
Yeah, I got one off my Uncle Luigi.
Yeah.
He was about 2'1", a lovely guy. You know, a little short Italian, he could hardly walk.
He was 2'1" once he'd been inside the ice cream mix. Sorry, Luigi, we need some more strawberry in you get again, mate.
I warned him about my relatives, and that's his problem.
Well, at 13, you formed a band with a schoolmate, Alan Lancaster. Mm. And Alan's intention, I believe, was to become Peckham's answer to Acker Bilk.
Yeah, it was. We were kind of... We played trumpets in the school. Look, he played trombone, I played trumpet. Because I tried guitar before with Dominic, and we were both going to be Everly Brothers, you know, and little shit got a train set instead. So I...
Now, your first manager was actually a local gas fitter called Pat Barlow, and he reckons that you weren't really the hard-rocking type.
There were two gangs, one called the Peckham Gang, one called the Bermondsey Gang. And inevitably, if trouble started up, I, along with my bouncers, plus Alan Lancaster and Jessica Volsky, our organs at the time, would sort it out. At the end of each time this happened, I had to go over to a little box under stage, knock on the door and say, Francis, you can come out now.
He's dead as well. And Alan Lancaster lost a tooth, I think, which he had trouble with it. Like somebody hit him with a Coke bottle.
Yeah.
And that really reaffirmed to me, this is not the place I want to be. If you want to be brave and get hit, go for it, not me.
Yeah.
I'm a coward.
But also, I think it's great to have a gas fitter as a manager, because then he can say, yeah, they're definitely playing Thursday, but I can't say whether it's going to be morning or afternoon. Now, your band was called the Spectres. Mm-hmm. And they used to travel to gigs in rather an unusual way, mm-hmm. didn't they? Here is John Coughlan, joined you on drums.
We had no means of transport. We didn't know how to get there, so Francis had this great idea. I know, my dad would take us down there in the ice cream van. And we'd put all the drums and the amps and mics and stuff in the back of the van and trundle off down the road. And, of course, then on the way to the gig, we'd stop and sell people ice cream on the way to the queue.
Is he hoping to be the new Bond villain?
That was lovely.
Well, we've actually got a picture of the Spectres.
Whoops.
There they are.
Yes.
And here's a picture of you all toasting your success after you got a summer contract to play at Butlins in Minehead in 1965. Yeah. And, of course, that was a key moment, because it was there that you met your soulmate in Status Quo, Rick Parfitt.
Mm. Everyone thought he was a puff, because he had a tight little bum.
Yeah.
And he used to...
Well, he came from
Cabaret. Yeah, I did. Lovely. Oh, you got me. Hang on, can I go there for a moment? But he was more of a kindred spirit than the others, somehow, and I don't know why or how.
Well, that just happens, doesn't it? You bounce off.
Well, as I said, then we used to play on that whole camp thing. We'd hold hands and... I suppose that was unfair to the others, really, because it was kind of shutting them out.
Yeah.
I just thought, well, that sounds like... No, but I mean, you know...
Well, strange enough, in 1967, you did actually decide to rename yourself, didn't you, as the Queers?
That was a suggestion... A suggestion of Pat Barlow's. We were rehearsing in his basement in Lambeth Walk. He said, we need something really contentious to call, you know, perhaps the Queers. I'm not sure about that. He said, what about Status Quo? We said, yeah, fine, go on, that'll do.
And by 1968, you were Status Quo.
Mm.
And then this happened.
Ladies and gentlemen, up from number 15 of last week to number 10 of this week, pictures of Max Tickman, the Status Quo.
That is a great look, that haircut.
Oh, back combed, glued, yeah. Stuck down, moustache was blacked out with the stuff. My dad showed me that. He was a funny boy, my dad. He used to light a match, blow it out, and darken the tash down. So.
You actually wrote that song?
Yeah, in the toilet.
And
I know,
you wrote
yeah.
it in the toilet.
Mm.
Interesting.
You should have been there. It was a great way to go somewhere else to be on your own, as yeah. it were. If you imagine trying, they're very narrow, and it was almost like this. Yeah. So God knows how I wrote the thing.
Yeah. Well, do you ever tempted to go out for a curry, and then you could write a whole album? So this was sort of psychedelic era, wasn't it?
Yeah, so they called it psychedelic. I had no clue what that meant. I still don't really.
But it ended almost immediately.
We'd been, you know, manipulated quite a bit, and that's. You kind of hope for that you were successful, and everyone's saying, oh, they're interested in you. But as soon as that, which was very quickly, began to wane, all these people had disappeared, so you were left to your own devices somewhat. And and for us, we would finish the whatever we were doing and go and watch Fleetwood Mac or Chicken Shack, and they would just go, dum, 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 dum. Mm. And we'd be there like that. Hour and a half later, we should do this shit, we like this shit. Yeah.
So eventually you came back. On Top of Pops, looking like this. And you were actually sponsored by Levi's, weren't you? The first ever sponsored band in British
pop history. We certainly were. You know what we got paid for that?
Tell me.
Denim.
Aftershave.
No, we were given our own piece of denim each.
That's nice.
Yeah, I dare say there was a few mil went somewhere, but Rick and I only actually realised about 10 years. That's how thick we are. About 10 years ago, we suddenly realised there must have been money for that.
That's fantastic. The idea that Levi's go, we can't give you money. What have we got in here?
Exactly.
We've got a bit of denim knocking about.
Exactly. We're a sheet of denim like that each.
Now, what about musically?
Ah. Tricky area with me.
What do you feel about criticism? Because the old joke is it's the same old three chords and things like that. Are you the sort of person that reads everything and it really winds you up?
Initially the three chord thing was funny, and then after a while you get the strangest people saying to you, of course, you're three chords. And I was being interviewed by somebody last year, and she said something to me about the three chords, and I said, can you tell me what a chord is? She said, nope. I said, do you know how many notes in the chord? She said, nope. I said, so you don't know what you're talking about? She said, no, I shouldn't have said that. I said, no. And most of the best music I've ever heard is usually over three or five chords,
yeah.
Whether it's country, rock, or some opera. Some of the arias are three chords. Some of the best classic main sections that we all love are three chords. And I always felt that if it meant by moving a finger to make another chord, Look at that magic. And does that make the music any better? You either like it or you don't. Yeah, and its melody's always got to me.
But people did spring to your defence. A music teacher, Ruth Green, actually compared your music to Mozart, your particular composing skills to Mozart. And I must stress to people at home that this clip is not a wind-up, it's not a Monty Python sketch. This is a real interview.
Their music is complex. It sounds simple, but it is complex. And they're very, very clever composers.
When did you discover, in that sense, status quo for yourself?
May, I think. I was listening to Lies, you know, and I was listening to the sort of... just suddenly discovered the bass part was moving tonic, subdominant, tonic, dominant tonic, which is fourth, first, fourth, fifth, and back to first chords.
But why did you put an album of status quo on your particular record player? Why them? How did you discover them?
Well, because I was psychologically in distress.
That's terrible. You get this superb intellectual critique of your music, saying how wonderful you are, and then right at the end she goes, but I do have a bit of a problem.
Well, I'm not well, sir.
I think a lot of people must have seen that and thought, what has she done to her hair?
Yeah, well, it was 70s,
except for
it?
Brian May, who's looking at it thinking, whoa! That is a good look!
That's good. So, I bet.
Now, by the mid-70s, you were huge. And obviously, with success in rock and roll, excess comes along.
Mm.
Here's your co-guitarist, Rick Parfitt.
I thought we'd go out one day, so I went and knocked on his door and just sort of walked in. And it was 14 girls in his room. I couldn't believe it. I thought, well, you know, rock and roll, this really is a rock and roll sight, you know. I sat on the windowsill and three or four on the windowsill and four or five on the bed, chairs, sofas, girls everywhere, you know. And just laying there in the middle of it, hello there, you know. Not a bad life, really. It was pretty rock and roll, that was. Sort of always had that picture, you know, of opening the door. Wow. Because I only had 12 girls in my room.
I was waiting for the punch. I'll do that again. However, it sounds fantastic, but, you know...
Yeah.
If you're in a situation downstairs in a hotel or a club and four or five guys will be after the same woman or, you know... And you get the woman, if you get the woman, and you walk out... and you get in the elevator, lovely, can't wait again. And you get in your room and go, why did I do this? And then you realise you've got to perform, and that's... Well, very soon for me, when... I've done that, yeah. Mm. I mean, like what they're wearing, and they always took their kit off, and I go, why'd you do that?
Now, the rock and roll excesses weren't just sex, obviously. There were drugs, and rather a lot of them. Here's your former tour manager, Bob Young.
I believe that quite often Francis and Rick would test just how far out of it and how far gone they were. By running into walls and when they were bouncing off, if it didn't hurt, then they knew that they'd had enough.
Good job you hadn't been on Viagra, hey? Oh, that hurt me. What though was your drug of choice, what they call drug of choice? What was your biggest downfall?
Lead him in. Cocaine. But I used to see people doing it and think, oh, disgusting, that is gross, you know. And someone said, try. I said, don't be a dickhead, I'm not going to do that. And somehow I tried it, and after that we were doing coke all over the place. And once we'd started, I had to have coke to get out of bed or to get in the shower. And when you start off with something like a stimulant of some sort, if this is how we live, if this is our moods, you take your first bit of coke, which has usually got some sort of amphetamine, speed, something. So you're up a little like that, lovely. And then tomorrow you need a bit more to get to where you are. And then eventually you are actually taking the coke to be... or the, whatever the drug is, really, to be exactly where you were when you started. Yeah. I knew it was going on. I used to know by washing my nose every morning. Mm. And you hear these things hitting the deck in the shower and wonder what that was. Mm.
Yeah. So what actually happened in the shower? Did you actually lose the cartilage in your nose?
It's the centre of the septum, guys, just right in there, yeah. But, people had always said, be careful, you've got a hole in the septum. And I'd seen lots of other people around. And it's strange why we don't ask each other. We're all kind of in the same business. And I'd see people with little studs and stuff in their nose here and think, well... No, I'm okay. No one said, no, the septum, you dickhead. Here, you know.
Just one final question on the drugs thing.
You've got a line before we carry on.
Do you think that the drugs contributed anything musically for you?
No, I think that'd be bullshit to say that. I think the drugs make you think that. They're going, no, remember, yeah, it was me that did this and you can't do this without me.
Yeah, that's the...
And
that's...
it can't be true.
Right, well, we've done sex, we've done drugs, it must be rock and roll next. Mm. Now, there was a bit of a split in the band, wasn't there, about whether you should become a heavy rock group or more of a good
something
time
like
pop
that.
Group.
Yeah, that's, yeah, you're right.
It was Alan, wasn't it, who thought that the band should be more serious and manly. He thought your name was girly, didn't he? So was it, in a sense, that why you and Rick played up the gay thing? He's more
probably,
to wind
yeah,
you up.
Probably, yeah, probably. I mean, yeah, yeah. He had this thing, he grew up in Peckham and... you didn't, you know, you could, it's, people couldn't insult me or Rick without enough hitting them. Yeah. He was just taught to fight. He was taught to never back down.
Well, this is the sort of stuff that Alan particularly liked. And this is what he hated playing. In fact, it wasn't even him playing there, was
no,
it?
No, he wouldn't come over, no.
It's a dummy. Let's just see the dummy. Yeah, but Patsy Kensit still married it.
Yeah, that was. He wouldn't come over for that song and...
He did very good miming there as well, didn't
it's
he?
Fantastic. Well, our manager was working him from the roof.
what were you saying? You're putting it in saying coke and sulfate then?
Yeah, well, me and Rick, you'd see coke or sulfate, we both sort of sped up there. You can tell by our eyes and our expressions. The times we went up to him and spoke to him and thought it was him was ridiculous. And I know what he means because I know where he's coming from, but that was the best thing for us to part at that point because... Yeah. He was either going to knock me out a few times a week, or we were going to seriously fight. I couldn't have fought with Alan Langer. He'd kill you.
But you even fell out with Rick as well. I mean, or Rick fell out with you. I'm not saying which way it happened.
No, coke does that. You anything that stimulates the body and gives you that confidence all the time. I can do anything. Sod everybody. You know, it just does that. It's going to destroy you, and it did us.
Mm. Let's have a look at the type of rows that you used to have.
He can't play the f***ing guitar.
You know the part, you did.
No, he doesn't know the part. If he knew the f***ing part, he'd play it, wouldn't he?
Are you walking out?
Great.
Walking out?
Great.
Just tell me what we're supposed to do, all right?
Well, we're supposed to play the f***ing, aren't we?
So good, that.
Obviously,
is.
Now, you've all seen Spinal Tap. Everyone's seen Spinal Tap. I'd just like to draw a few more parallels.
Know, yeah, no.
Here's Status Quo when they were the Spectres, and here's Spinal Tap when they were the New Originals. Here's Status Quo's psychedelic period, and here's the Spinal Tap's psychedelic period. Here's Tap bassist Derek Smalls, and here's Quo bassist Alan Lancaster. Here's Tap guitarist David St. Hubbins, and here's Quo guitarist Rick Parfitt. Here's the other member of Tap, Nigel Tufnell. And there's something awfully familiar about all of that, isn't there, Nigel? Francis?
Yeah, there is. And at the time when it first came out, everybody said it was us. And in fact, for a while, the crew would do it to us. They'd sort of, I don't know, you know about gigs, whenever you come out, there's guides everywhere for the band to go like with thick shits. And you go and you follow the white lines. And they did it to us a few times, let us up blind alleys just for the hell of it.
I expect you were very comfortable following the white lines, weren't you? But behind all of that rock star image, you're actually a very organised person, aren't you? Some would say over-organised, in fact. Here's your PR man, Simon Porter.
Francis often takes journalists by surprise. If they've got dirty shoes, he'll suddenly whip out one of those little shoe sponges and start cleaning their shoes. And he's got an obsession for having clean shoes at all times. And we were in a hotel, I think it was in Paris, and they had those little shoe polishers in the rooms. Francis was really taken with them, they're really nice ones. So he ended up, I think he bought 5,000 off the hotel, and he carries them around with him at all times in his puff bag.
He said he carries them around in his puff bag.
We call these puff bags. In the 70s, when used to be a place in Kenny Market you could buy these bags, and you know, to carry your cigarettes and whatever you had at the time. I got this little canvas bag.
You're a
heavy smoker. Well, hang on. And ever since, we've had puff bag. There's the major puff bag, then inside is the little Klein, which we call Kleiner Puff and Tasha, small puff bag.
True.
That's a doorstop for when you first get to a hotel and luggage is upstairs.
Oh, Rick carries his own doorstop.
Oh, it's a good reading glasses, regular glasses. What else have we got? A load of shit in here. Homeopathic sleepers.
That's your proudest possession.
Well, it's a baldy comb, you see. Because actually, it doesn't make any difference. I can do that and nothing happens. It's like, you know, there's loads of spare plectrum, spare hair ties.
But what about, these shoe polisher things that you bought for?
Okay, I know. If you want a polish, you can have a polish with me if you like. Now,
I'll tell you what.
Wait, that'll come up. We'll have a before and after here. We'll flog this. We'll be on one of those channels later on. There you go.
Thank you very much. You know when you said that you weren't sure if you were obsessive? I think you possibly are obsessive.
I think I possibly am, yes.
On a serious note, do you think that the obsessive, organised, new
me,
Francis, is part of the same addictive Francis?
Probably. I know, I'm not as analytical as that, but it's very good, yeah. Probably.
Now, by 1996, you chalked up your 50th hit, despite your, obviously, hectic shoe-cleaning schedule. and the 50th, I think, was Fun, 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 which got into the charts, but without any help from Radio 1.
The rock group Status Quo say they're planning to sue BBC Radio 1 because the station doesn't play their records anymore. The group, which was set up in the 60s, say they've been banned from the airwaves because they're too old. Radio 1 says its main aim is to play the best new music.
Now, famously, of course, the judge had never heard of you, but apparently his dad was a big fan.
That's nice, though. It was never going to get us radio play again.
No.
In fact, most stations followed suit after that, or a lot of stations followed suit. In retrospect, we shouldn't have done it.
But your fans were genuinely aggrieved, and here's the president of your junior fan club.
They're singing so clear, you can hear every word they sing. That's the most feeling, pal.
That is Rick Parfitt, in fact. See, without his makeup on, he doesn't look quite so good, does he?
He does burn it at both ends, doesn't he? Yeah.
Now, in 1997, there was a bigger sign of mortality loomed up when Rick had a quadruple heart bypass, which was obviously terrifying for him. How did it affect you, apart from your worries for him?
Well, David phoned me, and I was at home, and it was... he said, Rick's just gone to hospital, he's having a quadruple bypass. What? It's like, you know, it's not one of those things you expect to hear suddenly on the phone. What are you calling me for? And I was kind of stunned, and I put the phone down and went and told the wife. And it was really worrying for a while until I think I saw him about 2 days later. And once I saw him, he was fine. I knew he was going to be fine.
Yeah, well, he was quite shocked you visited him in hospital. Yes, here he is.
I'm laying there, and I had no idea, and he just kind of walked in, and I was really surprised that he'd come and seen me, really, because I didn't expect him to. It's not the sort of thing that he would do. Mind you, I suppose it's not every day your best pal has a sort of a quadruple heart bypass, I suppose. But I was quite surprised to see him. It nearly gave me another heart attack if it happened.
It's a good job you didn't wander in and say, Rick, I've learnt a fourth chord. You spent all that time on the road. You had 8 kids by 3 different mothers.
16 minutes of sex. You're envious.
I mean, looking back, do you wish that you'd had more time as a normal family time, if you like?
Yes and no, but I think that's a guilt trip, and I don't...
Yeah.
I try not to go there on guilt trips because things are as they are. When I'm at home, particularly myself at home, I don't go out.
Mm.
I remember when my dad... I always loved the winter and the grey days, the things that really piss most people off. I love a grey windy day or a rainy day or a snowy day. It meant my dad wasn't going out to sell ice cream. He would have to stay home. And the whole thing about my dad being at home and the fire being alight and that atmosphere of that time of year still really excites me, and I hope I pass some of that on to my kids.
There has been a bit of rebellion amongst your kids, hasn't there? Because one of them actually wanted to become, and did become, a policeman.
He tried, yeah, Nicholas, yeah. Funny boy.
Yeah. So you're happily settled with your wife, Eileen, and you're not seen quite so often these days in the British charts, but like many old rockers, you're very, very big in Germany, and you often play over there for the troops, don't you? Here's Jim Davidson.
When I phoned up and said, look, you know, listen, I'm chairman of the British Forces Foundation, I want to do a nice big show over the over in Germany for 10,000 British troops, and I want you to do it for nothing, he was the first one to say, yeah, we'll do it. We will be there. And the reason is because he's a kind bloke, he's an understanding man, he's a caring man, but the real reason is because they've got no other work.
You mean, oh, you silly sod.
It's rubbish to say that you've got no work, of course, because what about this appearance as backing band for the German star Stefan Remmler?
No, that's not fair.
This is great. See, they're not laughing now, are they, Radio 1, when they see that? We're going to play out now with a medley of some of your finest performances. But first, ladies and gentlemen, a big hand for the remarkable Francis Rossi.